That was a bit of a green persuasion. We're always banging on about carbon emissions, aren't we? Must drive the fossil fuel fans up the wall having to listen to people like me constantly droning on about how renewable energy might actually stop us destroying civilization as we know it and killing off hundreds of thousands of species of plants and animals. I mean, to listen to us lot, anyone would think we cared more about those things than we did about the relentless march of human progress and the all-important annual increase in global GDP. And let's face it, nothing's more important than an increase in GDP, is it? But there's always been a bit of a question mark, at least in the minds of some people, about one of the key claims of green energy. And it's all to do with how the carbon emission numbers really stack up when you step away from the end product comparisons like fossil fuel power plant carbon emissions versus wind turbine carbon emissions and start focusing on all the other stuff involved in producing, transporting, maintaining and ultimately disposing of these products. Some argue that when you do that, the playing field levels up significantly. So are they right? Does a full life cycle analysis of renewable energy sources versus fossil fuel energy sources reveal any nasty surprises? Well, let's have a rummage around and see what we can find out. Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. Back in 2013, a well-known climate skeptic organisation called the Global Warming Policy Foundation started touting around a study published that year that said that nuclear and fossil-fired power stations have much better energy returns on investment, or EROIs, than renewable sources. They got quite widely panned at the time, and the paper itself was rebutted by a peer review analysis from the University of Sussex that found that the authors had made serious methodological errors which invalidate their work. Nevertheless, the whole thing highlighted the perfectly valid and very important challenge of determining whether any new apparently green technology is genuinely capable of reducing the level of greenhouse gases that are emitted into our atmosphere globally over the entirety of its lifetime. In late 2017, another study was published in the well-respected science journal Nature. This one used life cycle analysis modelling combined with an integrated assessment model that accounted for the indirect greenhouse gas emissions as a result of industrial and other economic activity modelled up to 2050 in 11 major world regions. The goal was to provide a holistic view of future life cycle greenhouse gas emissions of low carbon technologies and power systems in the context of a climate change mitigation regime that would keep average global temperature increases below 2 degrees Celsius above pre-industrial levels. The generally accepted way to make that assessment is to work out total direct and indirect greenhouse gas emissions per unit of electricity produced. Once the researchers had crunched all those numbers, which I imagine was no mean feat, they arrived at a chart of all electricity producers in 2050 and split the emissions of each technology into direct and indirect categories. Coal and gas were both assumed to be fully incorporating carbon capture and storage technologies by mid-century. Whether that really happens is still open to much debate, of course, and even if it was achieved, the researchers still factored in a calculation for what they called imperfect CCS capture, which to you and me means gas leaks, or fugitive emissions if you prefer the posh phrase. Indirect emissions included land use and land use change, or LULUC, upstream methane from coal and gas, biogenic methane from hydropower, which mainly comes from stagnant water in reservoirs behind dams, fuels for construction and daily operations, and last but not least, a potentially negative emission number from bioenergy with carbon capture and storage, or BECCS. There's been a lot of pushback against BECCS since 2017, mainly because of concerns about destroying existing ecosystems and biodiversity to make way for monoculture plantations to produce the biomass. But we'll park that for the purposes of this exercise, because this chart deals specifically with emissions. The study provides a couple of useful numbers to compare to. It says that average fossil fuel emissions from global electricity supply in 2017 were 504 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour generated. Average emissions from electricity production in a 2050 2 degrees Celsius scenario will need to be only 15 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour. Even with CCS, coal and gas are both projected to be well above the required 2050 average, at about 109 and 78 grams respectively. Bioenergy works out at about 97 grams, mainly as a result of land use changes, but in theory, BECCS could provide a negative offset of as much as 300 grams for every unit of electricity produced. And that's a hotly disputed number, as I mentioned earlier. Some say the time required for crops and trees to grow sufficiently to suck all that carbon dioxide back out of the atmosphere will be too long to provide the quoted benefit by 2050, and that carbon storage losses from tearing down existing ecosystems could cancel out many of the benefits. So I think it's safe to say the jury is very much still out on the subject of BECCS. Those upstream biogenic methane emissions from reservoirs plus huge emissions from dam construction mean that hydropower, despite being heralded as a low carbon renewable, actually comes out at just under 100 grams of CO2 equivalent per kilowatt hour in a full life cycle assessment. Construction and daily operations do result in some greenhouse gas emissions over the lifetime of a nuclear power plant, but even so, nuclear technology comes out at only 4 grams of CO2 per kilowatt hour in 2050 in this analysis. The one element of uncertainty here is how we choose to dispose of nuclear waste in the future. Some countries are building very large and very deep underground vaults to hold their radioactive waste material, and that kind of construction involves vast amounts of concrete, steel and other materials, as well as huge quantities of energy to get it all constructed. So the genuine lifetime emissions costs of nuclear may well prove to be higher in real-world scenarios. Then we come to wind and solar photovoltaics, which you can clearly see have far lower lifetime emissions than the fossil fuel options. Solar PV comes in at 6 grams per kilowatt hour, and wind is only 4 grams. The vast majority of those embedded life cycle emissions come from the construction and deconstruction of the panels and turbines themselves. But contrary to the claims made by the critics of these technologies, those emissions come nowhere close to equaling the enormous amount of greenhouse gases produced by coal and gas, even with carbon capture and storage. And as renewable technology continues to rapidly improve, so those emissions will come down still further. In 2021, a more detailed analysis of life cycle emissions from wind power was published by none other than Bernstein Research, who describe themselves as Wall Street's premier sell-side research and brokerage firm. Hardly an archetypal environmental activist group, eh? Wind turbines use steel for their towers, and both concrete and steel for their foundations, and of course composite materials like glass fibre and carbon fibre for the blades. Unsurprisingly then, the construction using these materials makes up the vast majority of the life cycle carbon footprint for wind power, about 86% in fact, compared to only 1% for coal, which obviously does most of its environmental damage during operation. Rather than projecting out to 2050, the Bernstein report looked at a present-day comparison between electricity generation from fossil fuels and renewables. Coal and gas don't yet have those carbon capture facilities in place, which means emissions from coal currently run to about 1,000 grams per kilowatt hour of electricity generated, and gas produces about 450 grams per kilowatt hour. Solar PV comes in at 44 grams today, and the less well-known technology of concentrated solar power produces 27 grams per kilowatt hour over its lifetime. But both onshore and offshore wind are already challenging nuclear power as the lowest carbon footprint technologies available, even after all life cycle emissions are taken into account. The report highlighted even more recent analysis from the turbine manufacturers themselves, which puts the life cycle emissions of wind even lower than nuclear. Siemens Gamesa calculate life cycle emissions for one of their 8 megawatt offshore wind turbines at just 6 grams per kilowatt hour. Vestas reckon that a typical 42 megawatt onshore wind farm now has life cycle emissions of between 5.6 and 7.3 grams per kilowatt hour. A lot of that improvement comes from the sheer size of the turbines themselves, and also from the far more sophisticated and energy efficient shape of the blades. The Bernstein report shows us the size of a typical turbine blade in 1979 against a typical turbine in 2019, quite a difference. And because the turbine power rating scales with the swept area of the blade, materials intensity and therefore carbon footprint per unit of electricity reduces significantly as the blade size increases. The report concludes that taking the whole life cycle analysis into account, emissions from wind energy are less than 1 or 2% of fossil fuels, and there's scope to get that down even more as carbon emissions from steel and cement production reduce significantly in the coming years. Companies like Hybrit in Sweden are using hydrogen to replace coal in the reduction of iron ore, and others like CarbonCure and Carbicrete are developing technologies that will embed CO2 into cement rather than emitting it as part of the production process. And recycling is improving all the time too. 85% of expired wind turbine materials are already recycled, and the large turbine manufacturers are aiming to get that to 100%. In fact, Siemens Gamesa recently launched what they claim to be the world's first 100% recyclable blade, and Vestas are on track to get there by 2024. Once those technologies are embedded in the industry and similar recycling rates become widespread in the solar PV world, then one of the major barriers to mass adoption will have been overcome. Now, despite these findings, I know this topic remains a subject of much debate and disagreement. No doubt you've got your own views on the relative benefits and drawbacks of each energy generation technology. If you do, then why not jump down to the comment section below and share your thoughts there. That's it for this week though. A massive thank you, as always, to our fantastic Patreon supporters who keep these videos ad-free and completely independent. And there's just time to give a quick shout out to the folks who've joined recently with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Bob Phillipson, Jerry Forbes, Andrew Gross, Nicholas Cornoyer, Charlie Register, Jim Lemon, Connor Hawley, Francois Stransky, Greg Elkin, Heat Geek, Ralph Lawrence, Anne-Marie Fuller, Michael Isaacson, Dave Evans, Adrian Dickerson, Rene Kiemink, and Carl Guiney. And of course, a huge thank you to everyone else who's joined since last time too. If you feel like you could support the channel for about the price of a coffee each month, then you can find out how to do just that by visiting patreon.com/justhaveathink. And of course, the best and easiest way you can support the channel via YouTube is by clicking that subscribe button and hitting the notification bell. It costs you absolutely nothing at all, but that one simple click really does make a massive difference to helping the videos get selected by the YouTube algorithm from the millions of uploads it processes every day. It's dead easy to do. You just need to click on the little icon in the corner or on that icon there. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week and remember to just have a think. See you next week.